Hello, my name is Muriel, and I'll be going through the App Inventor tutorial for the two-button game. The two-button game is a multiplayer game that lets two players on their own devices compete to see how fast they can press their buttons in 10 seconds. This is a great illustration of CloudDB, which is the multiplayer component for App Inventor apps. Now, let me show a quick demo of how the completed two-button game will look. This is the completed two-button game. You can see that there's a button for player 1 and a button for player 2 that are currently inactive. When you press start player 1, the player 1 button will become active, and the same thing for player 2. You have a countdown of 10 seconds to press the button enough times to win against your opponent, player 2. This is best played with two devices so that you can each play with the device. You'll see that with the use of CloudDB, then it is able to save the score on both screens. Let me give a quick example. So if I start player 1 here, and I start pressing the button, you can see that the score is updated on both screens. And the same thing for player 2 here. I start pressing the button, and it's updated here. So the way to play this game is that each player on their own device chooses a player. So if I do player 1 and they do player 2, and we compete to see how fast we can press a button. All right, now let's get started on doing the layout. This will be the contents of part 1 of this video.
All right, to get started, go ahead and get on the website of App Inventor, which is ai2.appinventor.mit.edu. In the upper left-hand corner, you should see a Start New Project button. Click it, and we're going to name our project Two Button Game. And press OK. It will open automatically. Here, we have our blank project. Go ahead, in the Properties of the Screen component, set align horizontal to center and align vertical also to center. This just affects how it does the layouts and will make sure that every component is as centered as possible. Now, the first components that we're going to drag in are horizontal arrangements. You can find them in layout, horizontal arrangement. Drag in 4 of them. Horizontal arrangements are great because by default, App Inventor will arrange things vertically, but within these horizontal arrangements, you can put buttons and labels horizontally. Right, now we're going to rename each of the horizontal arrangements. Renaming them won't change what they actually do for us, but they'll be more understandable to us App Inventors and make it more clear what they're supposed to do. Go ahead and click on horizontal arrangement 1, press rename. And this one we're going to name Time Arrangement. For the next one here, Button Arrangement. For the next one, it will be Score Arrangement. And for the last, Start Button Arrangement. You can already tell that we now have a better indication of what might be going in these arrangements. Finally, for each of them, we should definitely set their width to fill parent. This will make them take up the full width of the screen. And we can take their align horizontal to be centered as well. Do that for all of them. There we go. This is what your screen should look like for now. Great. Next, let's add the actual buttons and labels that you'll be interacting with this app. Click on the user interface. Now we can drag out 2 labels and put them in the top timer arrangement. Label 1, label 2. Inside the button arrangement, we're going to need 2 buttons, which makes sense. Inside the score arrangement, we'll need four labels. And in the start button arrangement, right now we're only going to need one button, but that will change later when we will add a second button. Great, okay, now let's rename these labels and buttons so that they make more sense to us. This label we can rename to be time label. And this one we'll just rename to be time. These are the labels that will tell us how much time we have left to press the buttons. For this button one, we can call it player one button. And this one correspondingly will be player two button. These are the buttons each player will press. These four labels will correspond to the scores. So this one will be player one label. That will indicate that this is the score for player one. And this one will actually have the score for it, so we'll call it player one score. It's corresponding for these next two, so it will be player two label and player two score. And for this last button, we can just call it start button one. Don't worry if these names don't make a lot of sense to you right now. We'll definitely go through them as we give them actual functionality. Next, for each of these labels, you should go through their properties and set their text color right down here to red and the font size, which is here, to 20. You can go ahead and do that for both the time label and time. This will make the time countdown be red. Alright, now let's add some sense to the actual text that's on the page, right? So in time label, go into the text field and change that to just be time colon. And the initial time that we want to set for this time label, go to its text and just write zero, time zero. Okay, now for the player one button, set its text to just say player one, player two, of course. Now for the score, we want it to be very clear what score corresponds to what player. So this player one label will say player one colon, and the actual numerical score will set to zero in the text field. The next two will be quite similar, except it's for player two. Player two, colon, and their score will also be zero. And for start button, let's just call that start. Okay, now the just last thing that we need to do here is to make these buttons a little bit bigger, a little easier to press. So go to the player buttons and set the width to be 50% so that it'll take, each one will take half of the horizontal layout. Go to percent, put in 50, and we'll set its height to 150 pixels. This will make it way bigger. And do the same thing for player two so that it's the same. And there we go. This is the general layout complete. The last thing we have to do, which is very important, is to go back to the buttons and set its enabled field to unchecked. Also the same for player 2. That way the buttons are initially not enabled. You can't press them and have them do anything, and they only become enabled when you press the start button. We're going to code that functionality next. Go ahead and click on the blocks in the upper right-hand corner, and we'll do that now. So what we're going to be doing in the block section now is setting the two buttons to be clickable and making sure that the score increases when you press those buttons. This is different from the full demo that I showed you at the beginning, but we'll be doing this again in three parts. So by the end of part one, you'll have gotten the buttons working, and the rest will be done in part two and three. The first thing we want to do is that when you press the start button, we can reset the scores to zero because you're starting a new game, and we should enable the button so that you can press them and actually play the game. So let's go down to the start button drawer and do when start button 1.click. So first let's set the player 1 scores and player 2 scores to be zero. Go ahead and click on the player 1 score label drawer. And we want to set its text component, so what you actually see, we want that to be zero. Go to math at the very top when you'll see a number option. Great, and we'll do the same thing for player two. So I'm just going to duplicate this, drag it in, and change it to player two score. So remember, the score is what you actually see as a number on the screen. So now we can enable the buttons as well. To do that, we can go to the player 1 button drawer, and we need to find its enabled field, which is here. Set player 1 button.enabled. So the button is either enabled, it's true that it's enabled, or it's false that it's enabled, which means it's disabled. To get true and false, we can go to logic and grab a true. So since it's true that it's enabled, now you can actually press the button and do stuff. Same thing for player 2. We just need to change that to player 2 button. And there we go. That's the start button block. Now that the two buttons are enabled, well, what happens when you press the buttons themselves? Let's code that now. Do when player 1 button.click, and let's drag that in. So when you press the button, you want to increase the score by 1. So remember where the score is stored. It's stored in player 1 score and player 2 score. You can go back here and grab its text field again. There we go. And we want to make it 1 bigger than it was before. To do that, we need to add 1, which is addition, which is math. You have an addition block here. We're going to be adding 1 to it. So you can grab in a number and change the 0 to a 1. And what are we going to be adding 1 to? Well, we're adding 1 to the value that it just was, which is the old player 1 score.txt. So player 1 score.txt. So just what it was before. We're adding 1 to that. And we're going to do the same thing for player 2. You can basically do this by duplicating. When player 2 button dot clicked, set player 2 score to the previous player 2 score plus 1. And there we go. That completes the basic level of pressing the two buttons. Go ahead and test your app. Feel free to do that and make sure that the buttons are initially disabled and then they're enabled when you press the button. And then the score increments by 1. Go ahead, go to Connect and AI Companion, and you can use your mobile device to scan the QR code or use the emulator.
All right, this should be what you have so far. You have your two labels up here, two buttons, 4 labels to show the score, and of course your start button. you'll see that since we haven't pressed start, the buttons are not activated. They're not enabled, which is exactly how we set it up to be. And so now let's press start. See, the buttons look now very clickable. Let's see if we press the player one button a few times, you'll see that the score has changed. And if we press player two, you'll see that it increments by one every time that you press it. All right, this concludes part one of the two button game video. Please join us for part two, where we'll be setting up the timer so you only have 10 seconds to go through and press the button as many times as possible. Thank you.